Welcome back to the Rush Hour, and of course this is another segment and also a very, very interesting special session and coverage of the Kenyan election. We understand that two main rivals, the former Prime Minister Raila Odinga and William Ruto, Deputy President, are in a very tight race there, and of course results have started trickling in. And of course, before we do that, we ask you a question on our social media platforms. Here in Uganda, the Uganda Parliamentary Forum on Mental Health is talking about testing Ugandans before actually you go to her contest as a member of parliament. This comes after the Geoffrey Macho, the member of parliament, also the chairperson of that forum, say that some members of parliament may also be having mental challenges. Just join that conversation on our social media platforms at Urban TV Uganda on Twitter. Urban Television will be reading that comment throughout the show. Now, going back to Kenya, we understand that 12 million Kenyans, I suppose, actually took their vote yesterday. And of course, the results that are coming in from the Kenyan High Commission here in Kampala were also confirmed, as you know, Raila Odinga defeated William Ruto here in Kampala. But of course, we'll be having the final results coming in from the IEBC of Kenya. But before we do that, Lincoln Jisha and Vivian Kamsime are in Studio B, trying actually to monitor what exactly is taking place in Kenya, but also doing a survey and a search of what the Kenyan local media is broadcasting this morning. And of course, we'll be just comparing notes based on what is reported locally and of course, what is reported internationally. Lincoln Jisha, very good morning. And of course, we'll come back to this special coverage. I just want to understand what is the latest update that is coming in from Kenya, and also take us through what the local media there is reporting.
Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you very much, Mubarak, for that. Now, those of you who have just joined us, we understand that we are all on tension. The East African community is waiting to hear what is coming out of Kenya's general elections as of yesterday. But reports coming in, before we can get into the Kenyan media, reports coming in indicate that early results are showing Raila Odinga and William Ruto neck and neck. And it is reported that over 1.2 million votes so far, each putting them at 49%. This is according to some of the reports coming in. Now, they're saying that front runners Raila and Ruto have both vowed to maintain calm following Tuesday's polls. The memory of past elections-related violence remain very fresh to many Kenyans, and they're all urging political parties to stay calm no matter the outcome of yesterday's polls. Now, as you can see on your screen here, we're taking a look at the Standard in Kenya. It is saying it is putting William Ruto at 56.23%, that is of the 526,857 votes so far that they have come in his favor. Raila Odinga is at 43.05%. And that is according to the votes that have come in so far, at 403,397 votes. Professor Wajakoya is at 0.49%, and that is 4,578 votes so far. This is according to the Standard, which also is part of the KTN News. As you can see, they're saying that 94% of forms 34A have been reported so far. So it's not much. Vivian, yesterday we're talking about 34A, the forms 34A, and we didn't maybe tell the audience what that form is all about.
Of course, that form is one of the two forms, because we're also supposed to have the form 34B, which earlier brought issues between Azimio la Umoja and the IEBC, mm-hmm. because it was not printed. Only forms 34A had been printed and brought into the country. So that's what they are using to tally the results at the polling stations.
Does that make it, is there any difference between 34A and 34B?
Yes, those are the differences that they were actually having problems resolving at the time. But they agreed to use the form 34A to transmit these results, to tally first of all, and to come up with the winners that are being transmitted to Bomas. Mm-hmm. So it is actually that form that once it has been tallied and clearly totaled to detail, then we actually are able to determine who is the winner right at the polling stations center, the polling centers there.
So according to KTN, they're saying 94% of forms 34A have been reported. What remains now?
Of course, once they have been submitted, then we should be able to go to the details and then have the results being fed into the final national,
national
system plan. That is being broadcast at Bomas, that's where the results which are being transmitted by these different media centers are coming from. Of course, it is still too early to call, because as we talk right now, only 8.36% of the national tally has been done. That is quite too low, because we that is translating to about 2.5 million votes compared to the 12 million votes that are going to be counted.
That's right.
Some regions or counties cannot actually be called, because some villages within those counties have not yet submitted results. They are still counting those in those different areas. And we can't still say that these results are a good determinant of who will actually be winner.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yes.
We could take a look at what's happening in at this is KBC. This is Kenya Broadcasting Corporation. We see that polling centers to open. That I think that was about for yesterday. Let's see what else is happening in another Kenyan media. If Citizen TV, I think, has also been, you know, covering the events of yesterday's elections. So we get those details as and when they come in. But it's also reported that IEBC has actually said that 26,881 of the 46,229 polling stations have brought in their results. Now, according to Citizen TV, digital rather, I see that Raila, Vivian, if you could see, Ruto is at 49.73%.
3%, yes.
Yes, and Raila is at 48.99%.
So, and these are still provisional results. We are only at 8.36%
of the
tallying
votes,
tallying of the entire vote. So we are yet to see what is going to be coming in from the different counties. We have results from... could we just go to the different county results?
Yes.
We have the prisons there that have voted overwhelmingly for Raila Odinga, Narok, Baringo, Kitui there. Laikipia is a stronghold of Raila Odinga. The number, of course, of other different counties that we call key counties that's are bound to swing these votes.
Kericho is William.
Yes,
William Ruto.
Because this is around Mount Kenya region.
Yeah, exactly.
And that is one of yes, and that is not Garissa. These are some of the different counties within those Mount Kenya regions or around the regions that can actually help Ruto. We are yet to see what is happening at the coast, because the coast is Odinga's stronghold. There is Taita Taveta about there. Nairobi City, of course, was bound to be taken by Raila Odinga. Gishu, because he's a stronghold there. He's been a stronghold in that region in Nairobi, yes. Then Gishu is where Ruto comes from.
Absolutely.
That is his county.
Clearly.
And clearly he has taken, he's swept it almost to 100%, if you like.
According to these provisional results, Mubarak.
Because this is showing a voter take of about 93.09%.
Yes.
That is quite a good one in his own county. We are yet to see, of course, Mombasa, being part of the coast, is a stronghold of Odinga. We, of course, we also been looking out for the lower eastern regions, which are key areas where we are expecting Odinga to win. Majorly, the lower eastern region, the coast, the Rift Valley, are regions we hope, if Odinga takes completely like he should, without a bit of disorganization from Ruto, because he could actually take it, but not with the expected majority in there.
Okay.
And that could actually, when we are talking about the non-decisive leads, that can actually cause that.
That can cause that.
And of course, in the Ruto strongholds, we have the Mount Kenya region. The Mount Kenya region has not had a good voter turnout. They had about 44.4%
of the voter turnout.
Yes, and it is being said that Martha Karua could have an effect even on that 44.4%. And if that happens, then Ruto may not perform as well as we expected him in that region.
And you know, the world over, they're saying there was a really low voter turnout. So
generally. Countrywide. Mm. Yeah, Taita Taveta is a coastal area where Ruto has a pending land ownership issue there.
Oh.
Yes, and you can see Raila is taking it.
Wonderful. Mubarak, that's what the Kenyan media is reporting as of now. But of course, these are provisional results. We await the final results as is expected. So Mubarak, there you are. What are your thoughts on
before
this?
Actually you get out from there, I'm just worried. I'm started getting worried because some of the constituencies and the results are coming in from Mount Kenya shows that actually William Ruto is performing better that side. And that is where the critical question comes in, because we all know that Mount Kenya is likely to determine who the next president of the Republic of Kenya is. What does this actually signify, Vivian? And what are you reading between lines? Because we understand that, of course, it's going to be a very good performance at the coastal region for Raila. Mm. And the eastern part is going to be certainly, the western part is going to be certainly William Ruto. But then the decisive factor
certainly,
is
like
Mount
that word,
Kenya.
Certainly, because the western region is yet to be called for Ruto, because most of the votes have been counted there in the western region. And we are hoping, or it looks like Ruto may actually take it. Mm. Now, when you talk about the Mount Kenya region issue, of course, Ruto has put up a strong fight there, because we know that there's the influence of President Uhuru Kenyatta there and Martha Karua.
Yes.
And these are strong people or children or the daughter of the soil and the son of the soil who have been against him. And depending on how he actually takes or splits that vote between him and Odinga, then he could actually become a winner. Mm. Now, what is also critical is that Ruto has been able to put up a tough campaign in the areas or regions where Odinga is a stronghold. And he is managing to pick up votes that were actually expected to go for Odinga.
You know?
And that will be key in determining whether we shall have a decisive lead between the two candidates.
Mubarak, this actually reminds me of, you know, Anish was intimating to us that there's a mathematics of who can, you know, do what in which region. What is that mathematics you're talking about?
Of course, the mathematics here is very simple. For example, there are three key regions for Odinga.
Okay.
We have the Lower Eastern region, we have the coast, and the Rift Valley. If they really vote well, like we expect them to go for Odinga, then that will be a good pass for Odinga to actually take the presidency. And if he actually manages to get a good portion of the Mount Kenya regional votes there, that would be a nice mathematics for Odinga to actually become president. But if we don't see that happening, and then we have Ruto chance him in one of those strongholds, at least one of those strongholds, he goes ahead and performs well in his Mount Kenya region, then we could actually see Ruto become a president.
Wow.
But if we see Ruto like he has done, as the results are coming in right now, putting up a good fight in Odinga's strongholds, he still takes up his strongholds, then Ruto could actually bring an indecisive lead in there. The mathematics in the Odinga camp.
From what we are seeing, actually, Vivian, there and Lane, from what we are seeing on the screen, from what the Kenyan media is monitoring, we are monitoring the Kenyan local media, of course, to find out how they are reporting these results that are trickling in from the IEBC, but also what it actually going to mean for the Kenyans and the results they are coming in. Vivian, before actually we get away from that, I also want to get a feel of What are you reading between these this tight race? Because we've never had this kind of performances even before. Many of the presidential candidates have been taking early leads, but we are seeing 49-49. They are just
neck
points that are actually neck to neck.
Yeah.
What does this actually mean? If it goes like this in the next 5 million votes or 6 million votes, are we not likely to see a rerun in this election?
Talking about a neck-to-neck right now is quite a bit unfair, because the votes that have been counted are few and we are yet to see exact competition between these two. And most of the regions that have actually been put out are yet to bring out the figures from these three key regions where Odinga is a stronghold. I think once those kick in, then we should be able to nicely think about who could actually be winner in this case, and then start the predictions. Now, when you're talking about how the regions could actually influence the votes, you are also supposed to think about how the regions around Mount Kenya, besides the Mount Kenya region itself, the surrounding areas, how they are performing, because those could actually end up in Ruto's camp. Mm. And when that happens, then you're going to have Odinga win. Of course, Martha Karua is a key person in the Mount Kenya region, a major force that is bound to give Ruto a headache.
Yes.
Let's see how that is going to go in numbers.
We all have to wait, of course, what is happening from the Mount Kenya region, where there is no certainly strong presidential candidate. It's only the running mate of Raila Odinga there, Martha Karua, of course, putting there a very, very interesting performance. Now, before actually we move too much more, I just have to remind you that we are just broadcasting here at Vision Group Industrial Area Headquarters, and of course, we'll bring you to live events coming in from Kenya, and we are still monitoring the Kenyan media there. Of course, Lynn Komjish and Vivian Kamsima trying to get you the analysis that you all need. But before actually we get away from that, when are Kenyans expected to see the next president declared? Assuming, are we looking at it in the next 24 hours, 72 hours, or just a whole week as we are waiting for the final result?
Mubarak, accordingly, the chairperson of the IEBC has about 7 days to actually announce the winner. So within these 7 days, he can choose to announce the winner within the 3 days, within tomorrow, if once the results have been properly tallied and they have been transmitted to the VOMAS, which is the National Tally Center in Kenya right now, then we should actually be able to have the announcement made. That could happen in the next coming hours or in just within those 7 days.
But as long as it's
constitutionally
absolutely
stated by within their constitution, yes.
So I'm wondering, with the way they are neck to neck, chances are we might see that until
the next
probably
7 days.
In the next 7 days. And you know, my worry is that that is the time there's tension. Kenyans are on tension right now. They still are neck to neck, and that is a space that is room for anything to happen. But are we reading anything of that sort? As much as they are worried that a repeat of what happened in the previous elections could reoccur, I don't think, I strongly believe this time round they are a bit calm, and they are also trying not to, you know, go that direction.
Yes, they're a bit calm, but also one of the things that actually brought problems in those previous elections was the transmission of results from the different polling centers to the National Tally Center.
That's right.
Now, when there are lags in those transmissions or problems in how the results are actually transmitted, then you're bound to have people's temperatures
of course
running around and rising, you know? And that wouldn't be good. We have not seen that so far.
Yeah.
At least what is being read or concluded at the polling center is transmitted directly to the National Tally Center. And how that process is managed is definitely bound to keep people calm or get them up on their toes, and they will be all over.
Vivian, we'll actually be getting much more analysis on the results, but we want to take a look at the major issue that featured in these elections. We understand that me and Lynn, we were talking about this before actually joined us in the morning. The cost of an election in Kenya has become an issue. Many of these politicians have been accusing them, you know, one another of corruption, of using a lot of money in this election. What actually does this mean to the Kenyan election? And is it that much expensive that if you don't have money, you can't really be a candidate in Kenya vis-a-vis the national economy that side?
Of course, it's not that when you do not have that much money, you cannot organize an election. This is simply an exorbitant cost of $374 million to have this election. Just to put it down to an individual, it basically costs the IEBC about $17 per person to actually have this election happen. If you compute it to Ugandan shillings, that's about 66,000. That's quite a whooping sum.
A lot of it.
Yes, it's a whooping sum to go per person, which makes the whole system really expensive. One of the things that the IEBC has put up for that cost is the cost of the technology being used. And what is interesting about technology is that this is technology that is far ahead of them. And when you're talking about the chemist kits failing to actually work and read people's fingerprints, then those are the kind of challenges you are thinking about when you're wondering, did they really have to go for this kind of cost? The very highest in the world. It is going to be higher than the Nigerian election, which is coming up next year. It is still higher than the Indian election. The India has the highest population in the world.
That's true. The second largest. Yes.
So, and you can see it going above the second largest population in the world.
Over a billion people.
Exactly, which is quite a sum. If you translate this cost of the election to basically the key figures within the economy, then you wonder what kind of mathematics it is, because as we talk right now, the Kenyan economy, according to July figures, their GDP was $110.35 billion. They have debt obligations worth 12.1 billion shillings. You know that railway that has been causing them headache? They're supposed to pay for it 13.2 billion shillings. There are 800,000 youth there who do not have jobs as yet. We have about an official rate of unemployment between the ages of 18 and 34 year olds at 40%. So when you look at that mathematics in their economy,
the mathematics of the cost of election from the party of government
to their economy,
translating to the economy and actually the rate
of
the debt,
the cost,
you know, the public debt. Kenya is considered to be one of the countries
yes,
that have
most of this money
the highest
with
debt,
Chinese
about 68% of their economy. Does it actually? Does this election serve humanity, a common Kenyan,
of course,
or
it
serves
doesn't.
A particular group?
Of course it doesn't. Does not add up, because they already have an inflation rate of 7.9%. They had to cut down the cost of unga to half. We were seeing the government subsidizing fuel at a cost of $141 million as of July. So that does not really, really make good economic sense. But then you wonder why they actually went for it. Yet in the previous election, one of the criticisms that came in, even when they kept on fronting the technology that they had used as being efficient and a way of validating what they had done, then the judge told them technology is not democracy.
Wow.
So it is quite interesting how they have chosen this path and not a different path.
Mubarak and Vivian, in my view, we've got to start somewhere. At some point, somebody was tweeting that because they were counting votes and they were saying, Raila, 220, and someone was like, we are still in this era. And meanwhile, they're using a lamp, you know, like a pressure lamp of sorts. And and somebody's saying, this is rudimentary. I mean, it is in this year, 2022, we should be moving. So I support
What is so special about Kenya? Because, you know, Vivian talking about India, the second largest economy, rather population in the world, is not using this kind of amount. Nigeria being the largest economy on the continent does not use this amount. What is so special about the elections of Kenya that actually you need to invest in a lot of money amidst a lot of challenges, inflation, and of course the public debt that has not yet been settled?
That is a question that is still baffling the experts.
It's a million-dollar question.
And what is interesting about the election, again, is that PR,
PR
gimmicks
companies
going on within the different camps and the entire election terrain there.
So it doesn't stop from the government, you know, investing a lot of money in the IEBC to fund this process, but also even the camps of these politicians.
It is still part of them that they have to go an extra mile in organizing definitely their campaigns. One of the most interesting activity that actually put these candidates in the limelight was when they sponsored their aides to Greece at exorbitant prices still to go and monitor the ballots. Of course, only the Azimio Umoja candidates, Raila Amolo Odinga and Deputy President William Ruto, managed to send their aides
to Greece.
Yes, to Greece, alongside other election observers and non-government organizational parties that wanted to monitor all this. That was quite a sum because it was at their expense, not the IEBC expense. And you are wondering, where are these people getting the money from?
They have the money. First, we're here talking about this.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
What do you mean they have the money when dynasties. The Chinese banks have debts with Kenya?
But also we're talking about this same issue yesterday, Vivian and
yes.
Lynn,
yes.
With the chairperson of the Kenyans in Uganda here. Mm. We're talking about Kenya being the wealthiest country in East Africa.
East African region.
But certainly all these candidates are trying to convince the population that actually they are pro-people, meaning they are, the majority of the Kenyans are actually poor. How does that actually, how does that mathematics works? You are the richest country in the region, but actually your biggest population is a poor population. Does that actually, does this election serves the humanity or the population there in Kenya?
Actually, to sum that up, Mubarak, like one expert said, it just looks like a mockery.
Yes.
In the eyes of the people.
But yes.
Because at one rally, Raila Odinga came in with 7 jets just to attend the rally
now
with his aides.
You see how they were able to afford the grease trip?
Yes, of course we'll be getting back to that kind of analysis, and of course we leave it to the Kenyans to determine whether actually the system or this election and the cost works for them and whether actually it delivers the desired results. But Lynn Komyesha, before we get anywhere,
yes.
I just want you actually to bring us to speed of whether they will have updates from the local media of Kenya.
Absolutely.
Whether there is also updates coming in from there.
Absolutely. Now, this is Nation Africa. We're seeing Kenya elections 2022, and we are seeing William Ruto at 51.02%, and that is of 721,093 votes that have come in so far. Raila Odinga of Azimio is at 48.34%, and that is of 683,201 votes. Professor Wajakoya is at 0.425 votes so far. David Waihiga is at 0.21% of the 2,997 votes. But then they're saying, they're giving us that so far the total number of votes that have come in, tallied, is at 1,413,216.
Compared to the 12 million
To the 12 million. So far, this is according to Nation.
The Nation, they are in Kenya.
Yeah, of course, Nation in Kenya. So far, 4,640 of 46,229 polling stations have reported these votes, and they are putting a quick
winner.
A quick reminder,
yes.
The winner of presidential elections need 50% plus one of the valid votes cast and at least 25% votes in more than 24 counties. So this is still going on, and as of course the day proceeds, we'll get more details.
We will get, actually we just want to wrap up this morning session, of course, and the coverage of the Kenyan election. But before we do that, I'm seeing actually Professor Wajakoya George and David Waihiga.
Yes.
I just want to understand, why do we keep having candidates well knowing that actually they are not main runners? Vivian, why should we have, we had here Katumba Oye, well knowing that certainly he's not going to make it.
No future.
Why do these candidates actually still run until the end of this process?
Mubarak, it is their constitutional right to do so, because if you do not agree with the other candidates, what are you doing about it? Then you should come out and state your agenda so that you can woo a certain number of the citizenry. If you actually take it, because democracy is about numbers, then you can become president.
You
and that's what it's about. What is interesting about that particular point is that the IEBC denied a certain number of Kenyans who wanted to come into this race as independents, because they did not have over the about 20,000 signatures and photocopies of national IDs, according to a requirement it was setting from the Constitution. Of course, court quashed that requirement, but then we've not seen them join the race. They went back asking to be put back into the race. Specifically, Chigame had asked court to compel the IEBC to allow him into the race. That did not happen.
Would they actually have changed the figures that we are seeing, the results, if the independent candidates were part of this context?
Who knows?
They have had an impact in Kenya.
Indeed.
Who knows? perhaps they could have swung some or split some of those votes. Because Chigami stood on the ticket of disability. Perhaps he could have gotten that disability vote and made a difference.
In a way.
Who knows?
Actually, we want now to bring to an end Lynn Komjich and, of course, Vivian Kamsime to this whole coverage of the Kenyan elections. And, of course, our normal programming will continue later in the day. But before we do that, let's just do a wrap-up. I just want actually to pick your view, Lynn and Vivian. You posed a question yesterday before Isaiah here. What does actually this election going to mean if Ruto and Raila wins? If any of them wins, what exactly is your view and Vivian too?
For me, Ruto brings onto the table the young hustler, you know, and a whole different approach to to life has been in Kenya. But then that is also a decision for them. But it would be such a fantastic solution if he comes on, because he has he's focusing on the youth and how to uplift everybody, considering his background. That, for me, is what I look at. With Raila, I'm sorry to say, but I don't see much of a change. When he comes in, he's bringing still the dynasty situation. We know the people who have been in power for long and have done all these things. But then perhaps, because he's riding on the issue of anti-corruption campaign, hopefully we can see a change in that direction, but not very much. I'm not very optimistic with Raila coming in.
You've reminded me of Hajepam here in Uganda. Do you want change or more of the same? Vivian, are we likely to see a change
or
more of the same? And who brings change and who brings more of the same?
Of course, when you're talking about change, you're talking about Ruto, because he has disagreed with the system that Uhuru has had. And Uhuru has come out publicly to say that it is the Azimio la Umoja camp that is going to advance his agenda. Mm. And Ruto definitely would want to bring in fresh blood. He says the will of the people would have won. Mm. And we will see what that means. Now, when Ruto wins, definitely it will be a done case for Odinga, because, of course, by the time he finishes his fifth term, Odinga will be a bit advanced in age. I'm not sure he would want to come back.
That's right.
For a sixth round. So that could actually put a hold on some of these dynasty issues going on in that camp. Mm. However, if Odinga wins, definitely Deputy President William Ruto will be the face of the opposition, and he'll be fighting on to actually take up the next election.
Absolutely.
Of course, the agenda of the Jubilee governments will definitely be reinforced, plus the legacy of President Uhuru Kenyatta as being an end to the dynastic rivalry between the Luo and the Kikuyu issues will be cemented. Thank you.
So does actually this mean that we are likely to see a different Kenya from what we have seen? Because when you're saying that by Ruto we are having a change, but he's been part of the system and he's been part of the government, what kind of change are you talking about?
I think Raila and Uhuru's handshake changes a whole lot of things in a way. But when you say this is, it's not change that you're talking about, I think it's the change she is actually talking about.
There definitely will be a change in policy, because he will want to assert his legacy as well.
Of course.
He, of course, came in because of Moi, his Kalenjin. He may change actually the political terrain there, in terms of the dynastic rule going on there. Plus, also, of course, the wealth is among a certain category or class of people. And if he's really passionate about his hustler nation deal, then we may actually see a difference in the kind of class that actually has the money.
Absolutely.
As we move on.
Have you actually learned any lesson from this election?
As who?
Lynn?
As who?
As a Ugandan.
As a voter, maybe.
As a Ugandan.
There's a lot to learn from Kenya elections. Mm-hmm. First of all, there's a whole lot, really. The problem is, can we actually be like them or even better than them? That's the question I cannot answer.
That's a question you cannot answer. Vivian, have you learned anything from
Kenya?
Of
course, there is the major thing we have learned, that you can actually have an election with internet on.
Fantastic. We're even able not tap into that because they are alive and
peaceful.
Yeah.
Does it speak to the fact that the Kenyans are responsible internet users than Ugandans?
Because
maybe sometimes you abuse that. But anyway, that's actually for the Ugandans to determine and also for the Kenyans to determine. But of course, thank you so much, Vivian Kamsime and Lynn Komjisha, for that wonderful analysis. We hope we are going to continue bringing you live updates that are coming in from Kenya and, of course, in our normal programming. We are actually going to end here, but of course, results be well known, be in the know that New Vision and Vision Group platforms will be continuously updating you on what exactly is taking place in Kenya and who the next president of Kenya is going to be. Is it going to be Raila or is it going to be William Ruto? Thank you so much for being part of this special coverage. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We meet tomorrow.
This weekend.
Musikani enongate nyo enayaka. Tenda we wore motoka. Wore mekufanga tofuse motoka.